Welcome to Classic Albums at Home. I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and thank you so much for joining us tonight. Since isolation and lockdown, we at Classic Album Sundays, we've moved all of our events online, and we also started a subscription offering on Patreon, where we have memberships where you can go to three different events a month, including our album club, the Classic Album Pub Quiz, and also our Safe and Sound Hi-Fi webinar. And that's for £10 a month, and you can find out more at patreon.com/classicalbumsundays. We also started a whole series of events called Classic Albums at Home, where we're joined by our DJ friends and musician friends discussing the albums that have really kept them company and given them solace during isolation and these very strange times that we are living through. Tonight, our special guest is the youngest founding sister of Sister Sledge. And you have to remember, they recorded their first single, Time Will Tell, in 1971, when she was just about 12 or 13 years old. Then they went on to become one of the most popular female vocal groups. They recorded 8 albums together, including their third album, which was a huge breakthrough and a huge hit for them, We Are Family, of course. And then she went solo in 1989. She recorded her own LP, Heart. She had a hit with Take Me Back to Love Again. And she's worked with some great DJ producers, including Horsemeat Disco and Robert Miles and my friend Kingbrid as well. And I'd like to welcome you. Hello, Kathy Sledge. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hello. I'm so happy to be here. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. I'm good. Good to see you. We met. I'm glad I did meet you a couple years ago when I was doing the podcast for Atlantic Records. So I feel like we have a bond. So it's not just, you know, over the ocean looking at you through a computer.
We all are doing right now. So yeah.
Exactly. Now, we were just listening to some Mozart while we were in the waiting room, and I think your mother was a very, very strong character in your upbringing, a very strong, strong, strong woman. And is she the person who turned you on to classical music?
Well, actually, that would be my grandmother more. My grandmother was an opera singer. Mm-hmm. And she was a protege with Mary McLeod Bethune.
Yeah.
And she actually was the one that really gave us an appreciation for music. But the Mozart part was just, I could say, just strictly me. I just always have been a huge Mozart, more of his upbeat stuff too. Like I just think, you know, his music sets me, it sets my day. And I usually turn it on in the mornings. It's usually praise music or Mozart.
Right.
No, you know.
And what about Mozart appeals to you?
Well, you know, I took this crash class on composers and their life. And I've always been a big Mendelssohn fan as well. And Mozart learned a lot from Mendelssohn. And I think their music, at least in my opinion, is always lightweight. It makes me feel lifted. And that's what I like about Mozart. I think, you know, I find a place of comfort in a very lightweight way. So it's nothing heavy. And it's gotten me through many of tours. Sometimes I'll put on my Mozart. I always say classical music is to the fall, is to the autumn, as reggae music is to the summer.
I like this. Also, I start off my day with classical music quite often as well. I'm a big fan of Debussy.
Oh, yeah.
So that kind of, the more impressionistic kind of composer, but also Vaughan Williams and getting more and more into Brahms and Beethoven as well. But there is, you learn a lot by listening to classical music, but also your mind can wander. And I think you were saying before, you know, you start your day that way. And it's a nice way to kind of ease into the day. Maybe not any kind of heavy opera, but
just the lightweight, light classicals. And then I have to say too, my husband was always a trained classical musician, and he taught for the, he played with the Delaware Philharmonic Orchestra. And so, you know, we have that in common. You know, we were just talking about Beethoven yesterday, and it's interesting. I always say I'm the one that kind of spoiled him with rock music. I mean, all kinds of music, but classical music, there's a place for it in my heart.
Fantastic. Now you have been doing something similar to what we're doing, and you've been doing your own thing in lockdown called Songs of Comfort. Can you tell us about that?
I have, Colleen. You know, Songs of Comfort is mainly when we all went into lockdown, and we still don't know what's going on outside our window.
No.
You know, I especially thought about the people who were quarantining alone, and I felt, what can I do? And I had different friends and fans just inbox me asking me, well, I do music. Can I sing some songs? And I really thought about it because I didn't want it to look like, oh, now I have a captive audience. It really was more, what can I do? You know, I wish you could write a check for $1 million to help people who are really going through whatever. But I said, I can give the gift of music. I can give the gift of comfort through music. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it wasn't just a gift of music, but it was a gift of comfort. If you can find a place of comfort, you know, and it's really gone well, you know, and I'm very particular about the songs that I sing. I make sure that they're relevant to what we're going through right now. I try not to sing any songs about heartbreak.
We don't need that right now.
No. The first song I sang was, I Say a Little Prayer for You, because it was true. I think, yeah. You know, and from there we just, now I every now and then, if someone suggests a song that I think I'd love to sing, you know, I'll do it. And it's become a concert series. And I just, once a week, you know, I'll go in and I'll sit in the same chair with, you know, these huge plants behind me. And I just sing a song of comfort.
So what are some of the other songs?
Well, I tell you what really, really surprised me. I did an acoustic version of Thinking of You, which is one of my favorite songs to sing. And unbeknownst to me, like I knew that they were starting to play it in what we have here called Club Quarantine with D-Nice, with a DJ who brought the world together all in one place. And he started playing Thinking of You. And I did this acoustic version and it went viral. And, you know, but my reasons for doing it, it was one of the most requested songs. And I love singing it. So between that, Say a Little Prayer for You, there's a song I love to sing called Fallen from the Pretty Woman soundtrack. Because I've fallen for you. Just a beautiful melody. I sang that. And then I started getting, you know, I have a list, trust me. And what's interesting is it takes time to do the songs. It's not like I just choose them. I collaborate with different musicians and I love acoustic versions of them. And we rehearse, you know, over the phone, or sometimes we Zoom rehearse, and I make sure there's a gorgeous track. Like I think Lovely Day will be one of the songs. I've just tracked that with Randy Bolin. And it's just exciting to be able to have a way to reach people who need or feel like they need a comfortable place. And that's what Songs of Comfort does.
It is amazing. We humans do reach out for, we need community. We need to be together, even if we're physically isolated from one another. And, you know, I did a similar thing. I had to get on the radio. I had to keep doing events. I was doing presentations, classic album presentations online, all for free, just, you know, just doing it just to communicate. And I think that the thing, there's two things to kind of take out of this. One is that sense of community and this kind of conversation with the people out there. Yes. But also on a personal level, it must be so gratifying to know that you do this anyways. You do this because you love it.
Yes. I'll never forget the first time I ever got my sisters and I, where I think I was 11 years old. We were always singing. We were always harmonizing. We were harmonizing while we were jumping rope or playing jacks. And then someone asked us to sing at a concert and they were going to pay us. And I was like, I would do this for free. Like, sure. See how it started. I never remember saying as a little girl, when I grow up, I want to be a singer. It was just destiny. And I do love it.
What did you want to do when you were growing up?
I've always wanted to do something that has to do with children and working with children. And all through college, I studied therapeutic recreation for basically children with special needs. And then through that, I found music therapy. But around the time that I was through university, I was also like on the road all the time. So I got a chance to explore other avenues and other interests. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, growing up, I knew it would have to do with working with children. Never, not really a teacher, but more more in the recreational field.
And it's interesting because I believe all four of you, did all four of you go to Temple University?
Yes, I went to Temple Five, actually, our fifth sister.
All five, right.
And she's so a teacher. I mean, she's a retired educator now.
And your mother, was she adamant that you also get an education, even though you were working really hard? You had a lot of records coming out in the 70s and touring internationally. That must have been difficult.
Yeah, you know, we didn't have a choice. If our grades were not, if we didn't have strong grades and good grades, then there was no music. You know, that was always the priority. And a lot of times, Colleen, like teachers worked with us throughout, and they would always put together a work plan if we had to go away for 2 weeks. Let's say I had to go to Tokyo for a week or 2 weeks for festivals. And we would find ourselves ahead of the class because the teachers would sometimes think that their work plan was going to move accordingly. So it kind of worked out. We would always be a little ahead.
So you were all A students then?
We were all A students.
I expect nothing less.
Especially my sister Joni, God bless her, she's no longer with us. But Joni was just exceptional with her grades all the time and loved the French language and France, and she would travel there, and she actually lived there for a while and went to the Sorbonne, and she really had a passion for anything French.
Right. Anything. Well, we'll leave that there. Well, let's talk about some of the songs that you've chosen tonight. And the first one that you chose is by just a band that I can't even think of a single person who would not like this band.
I know.
Earth, Wind, and Fire. I mean, if you don't like Earth, Wind, and Fire, I don't want to offend anyone, but I think I just might be offended if I like found life. Someone.
They're life to me. They are life. They're life on vinyl. They're life through the sound waves. If you don't like Earth, Wind, and Fire, then you don't like life.
Or love. I mean, they're love as well. I mean, their music is just pure, pure, pure love. And they always have such positivity in their lyrics. It's always about uplifting. There's so much incredible positive energy. And this album was from the album album Raised from 1981, and the song is called Let's Groove. And it's kind of interesting because in a really strange way it kind of ties into a similar thing that probably happened to you, where in the late 70s there was a whole kind of disco backlash, and so many different African-American groups suffered from this. I remember speaking with Nile Rodgers about this. You and I have spoken about it before. Earth, Wind, and Fire. And in a sense, when they did this song, Let's Groove, in 1981, this is after the backlash, but they almost are reviving that kind of pure disco sound. I'm talking more about the Philly kind of disco sound.
Yeah, and it's interesting because it's the chord changes, you know, they're intricate, and they're also more than disco. Like, it's more groove. Like, if you wanted to personify what a strong groove song is this.
Mm-hmm. You know? So tell me about how did you fall in love with Earth, Wind, and Fire?
How do you not?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's just like you learn as a musician there, you know, I always listen to vocal harmonies. In fact, we were up against Earth, Wind, and Fire, and they won the Grammy. At that time though, all the groups were in one category. They didn't have like a female group, you know, category. So we were in vocal harmonies and vocal arrangements. So when Weir Family was up against After the Love Is Gone for vocal arrangements, I was like, oh, you know. With that said, you know, between Maurice White and Verdine and Philip Bailey, they and all the other members, of course, they were so expert at finding harmonies and melodies and intricate melodies, and even on the simplest songs. And that's what I think they did with Let's Groove. You know, normally I would choose, we all love September.
Yeah.
You know, we love September. But I said I wanted to choose something different because this is the kind of song that you know you love, and then you remember how much you love it once you hear it.
Absolutely. Well, that's a great way to introduce it. Shall we have a listen to it? This is Earth, Wind, and Fire with Let's Groove. Such an amazing tune. Just like pure life energy, isn't it?
We have to move the tables and dance.
I was thinking about that too. I was worried I might be like a headless chicken though if I was dancing back there, then my head would cut off. So I decided to dance in my chair. Great choice. Now the next artist you picked, I have to say the same thing as I did about Earth, Wind, and Fire. I don't know anybody who doesn't like this artist, and the artist is Stevie Wonder.
You know, I say we're living in the day and age of a Mozart and a Beethoven and a Brahms. Stevie Wonder, you know, there's Beethoven, Brahms, Wonder.
Yeah.
The genius in him is unmatched. Mm-hmm. And we are actually walking amongst him. He's walking amongst us, I mean. So yeah, I love him.
Have you met and worked with Stevie ever?
I have. I've met him, and I always say Stevie Wonder got me through a tour once. I was working in Australia for a month, and he would always call me back. Yeah, I would get lead messages. Mm-hmm. I hear that he can be nocturnal because he likes to work at night. And, you know, there's a flip-flop with the time zone in Australia. And he would call me back sometimes. And sometimes I would get, so, especially on the road over there, just to hear a friend and a voice. And Stevie Wonder at that. But, you know, what everyone says about him is so true. He's one of the kindest people. Hugest heart that you would ever know. And he has, you know, he just has such a way about him. I was honored to be able to work with him certain times and to get a chance to record one of his recordings. I did another star work, or covered it. But he's amazing.
Absolutely amazing. Now, we know he renegotiated his contract with Motown after Marvin Gaye did What's Going On, and he had full kind of creative control. It was kind of an unprecedented contract. So not only a pure creative genius, but also had his business smarts as well, you know, and then just went on to produce this body of work that is just awe-inspiring. You think Music of My Mind, Talking Book, Inner Visions, Songs in the Key of Life.
Every album.
Yeah. And you know each song word for word. And you chose a song from Songs in the Key of Life, which isn't one of the most popular songs, but it does start the last side. And the last side four has If It's Magic, and it has As, of course, which is just incredible. So, you know, that's just an opus. And also Another Star, the song that you also covered. The song that you chose is I Am Singing.
I Am Singing. And it's so right now for what we're going through. If you listen to the lyrics, it's just it's perfect. You know, they're so relevant. But Stevie Wonder is timeless, you know. Mm-hmm. And so this song, this is the song that, you know, as a younger girl, a little girl, I think I was in my teens, I would dance around in the living room too. I just love this song. And it does something to my heart. It's uplifting. Mm-hmm. And this is the song that just lifts your spirits.
Okay, great. Well, let's have a listen to this. I Am Singing from Stevie Wonder. So beautiful. I can see why that would really appeal to you as a singer too, and singing from the heart and what you've been doing with Songs of Comfort. But I kind of wanted to rewind a bit back to your grandmother again, because it was your grandmother who really taught you about singing. And what lessons did she impart to you and your sisters?
She actually was the person that would teach us to sing, like teaching us harmony parts. And you know, in retrospect, when I think about it now, I must have been 4 years old, if not younger. I remember her giving us parts on the piano. And Colleen, I remember not being able, because it was an upright piano, but I remember I was so little, I couldn't see the keyboard. You know, I was looking up, you know, but I would always remember my note. And I can only imagine her realizing that her granddaughters could harmonize and sing, and her being a classical artist and realizing, wow, they actually can carry this harmony at 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 years old. And we were. Actually, that's the first place we ever sang. Our grandmother was always into theater, and she would have teas. You know, she would give a tea at her church, at different church fellowship meetings, or, and so we were always pretty much entertaining. Even back then, I would do Langston Hughes skits with her. She was always in the arts. And so she is the one that gave us a deep appreciation for the arts and music and harmony.
Wonderful. That's so great. Now, was it your grandfather as well who was also a performer?
No, that would be my
father. Your father. It's your father. Was he a dancer?
Yeah, no, he was so remarkable. I'm actually actively working towards getting his tap shoes in the African American Museum, because, as you know, with time we learn more and more. And now if you Google Fred and Sledge, and that was his tap duo team, basically he was one of the first African Americans to break barriers on Broadway as a dancer. And he danced in Kiss Me Kate. And you know, what's so amazing is I can Google this stuff now, and I can, you know, there's an old recording, you can Google it, and I recognize my father's voice doing the background in the musical. It's amazing. So yeah, and he was what you would call a hoofer, you know, like the Nicholas brothers. And so the music and the theater, it's always been instilled through our culture and through our family and through our lineage. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But also being very pragmatic and getting those educations as well. I just think that's just so incredible that you managed to do all of that. And at such a young age. I mean, you were so young. How old were you when We Are Family? You were about just 20, weren't you?
Well, no, I was 16 when I recorded
it. 16 when you recorded it.
Oh, but I grew up through the whole time of We Are Family. I was 16 when I recorded it. Mm-hmm. And then it just lasted a lifetime, because the song lasted forever, that I literally, you know, I remember getting married through We Are Family. You know,
I think everybody does. Everyone remembers getting married to We Are Family.
My wedding song. But I was 16 when I sang, and I got married, and I was 21, 22. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you know, around that time, it just kept coming back. You know, it was always a song that would resurface. Mm-hmm. And to this day, in fact, when I talk to different people that work with me, I never start off with, do you remember We Are Family? You can just say, you know, the song We Are Family, which means it has just outlived the test of time. It's like saying, do you know Happy Birthday? Absolutely. You don't have to say, do you remember Happy Birthday? It's that kind of song.
Absolutely. It's brought joy to so many different types of people throughout the world. So that's what an amazing achievement, The next artist that you chose, sadly, is somebody we did lose in the last few months. I mean, we've lost quite a few amazing artists, like Mana Dibango was one of the first ones I remember. Florian Schneider from Kraftwerk, another incredibly iconic musician. And this one, I remember I was on the radio doing a radio show, and my husband came in and told me the news, and I was just shocked, and that's Bill Withers.
I know. But, you know, Bill Withers, to me, I always used to say, and I had the honor to be able to work with Bill Withers. I was 13, 14 years old, and I traveled and performed at Rumble in the Jungle, and he was one of the artists with James Brown and the Pointer Sisters and Hugh Masekela. So I got a chance to work with Bill Withers at a very young age. And what you see is what you get. He was always still Bill. He was one of those earthy, down to earth guys. You know, we opened for him at the Club Harlem in Atlantic City. There are lots of great memories. But what I love about him most is I always say Bill Withers and his writing and his lyrics to me is what Norman Rockwell is for the American culture. Bill Withers is for African-American culture. He paints a picture of our culture with grandma's hands and, oh, Saturday Night in Harlem. It's our heritage. He writes out those lyrics, and he connects to what we are as a people, and he tells the stories. And so I felt the same way. We lost such a great artist when we lost Bill Withers, but he left so much with us.
Absolutely. And how extraordinary. I just want to kind of back up as well to Rumble in the Jungle. You were, again, a teenager traveling on a plane with all these amazing artists going to Africa. It's with Mr. Brown as well. I mean, performing. I mean, you must have learned so much because also it's not like these types of things were that ordinary anyways. Like now people travel around, there's big festivals everywhere. Right. This is still the early stages of the development of the music industry, really, really, yeah, the popular music industry.
I mean, you're right. It was actually one of the first because it was at the time the promoter Don King, and you know, the whole idea with Rumble in the Jungle was to bring exactly what you just said. Was one of the first festivals. It was to bring the whole world to one place. Of course, that didn't really happen. But I love telling the story that no one knows, you know, because Will Smith portrayed Ali in the movie, and they did film a part of Rumble in the Jungle, but they left a hugely significant part out. I don't know why, but at the time, they built an 80,000 seat stadium for this, that's for the fight. And the indigenous people there, the tickets were $20. And that's what the indigenous people made in maybe a month. Mm-hmm. And so a lot of them couldn't afford to go to see the fight. But if you remember, the stadium was full. And that is why, right before the fight, Ali and Foreman met because the then dictator, Mobutu, wasn't allowing anyone in the arena. And it was an empty arena that they would be fighting in. So Ali and Foreman met before the fight in their dressing rooms and said, we're not stepping foot in that ring until you open those gates. And they opened the gates, and it, you know the history of it. It was filled to the rafters. And I just, you know, that was to me, to be able to tell that personal story and to be there and to be a part of the festival. Just, you know, I can't, it's something I can't imagine that I got a chance to be a part of.
Yeah, that's amazing. It is absolutely amazing. And what was it like working with Bill Withers?
Bill Withers had to be one of the kindest. He was, you know, he was always Bill Withers. He didn't do anything he didn't want to do. He would tell you how he felt.
Yeah.
But I remember, the first word that comes to mind is there was a stoic way about him, you know, and he was an artist that was so natural at what he did. That's what you see is what you got, you know. Like I know why he called one of his projects Still Bill, because I think to the end he always was who he was.
I think his debut album, was it Just As I Am? I think that's his debut album. I'll look it up on Google afterward. I have it. It's right behind me, but I'm not going to go find it right now. Okay. But yeah, it is kind of what you see is what you get. Now, you picked the song Lovely Day. Can you tell us why?
I just love this song. And you know, I've always loved the song, and I don't even remember who it was, but I remember a friend, I don't even know where it was, but I was sitting waiting in a lobby area and the song came on and the friend started telling me the lyrics. You know, we always know the hook, a lovely day, but when they were just reciting the lyrics, you know, it's the most simple lyrics, but the most real as you can get. You know, when I always feel like someone's always ahead of me and then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's going to be a lovely day. It's just as simple as it gets, but just so pure from the heart. And that's how Bill Withers writes.
Well, let's have a listen. This is Bill Withers with Lovely Day. That's so beautiful and uplifting. Before I go any further, I just want to let everybody know who's watching that you will have a chance to ask your own questions to Kathy at the end of the session. And if you do want to ask a question, there's a little box down the bottom that says Q&A. You can press that and our moderator will make sure he'll let you know like when you can ask your question, and that will all happen at the end, but he will be handling all of that. So just feel free to start writing in your questions now. Now we're going to move to some of your own music, which is always great. And you were saying earlier that one of your favorite Sister Sledge songs to sing is Thinking of You. And why is that?
It just is my all-time favorite. It, you know, if you think about the structure of how and the formula of how the Weir Family album, Nile Rodgers and Bernard Edwards would write, is very simple. You know, like, we are family. Everything was simple. Lost in Music, you know. But Thinking of You, it's just the melody. And as a singer and an artist, I love singing melodies, and you know, I'm thinking of you, da 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 da, da 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 da. It's just beautiful, and it has resurfaced in so many. And you know, in the UK, it's always been as big as We Are Family. So performing it, but now with what we're going on here with Club Quarantine and D Nice, you know, as a DJ, he totally resurfaced the song. So it's new to so many people here, which I'm happy because I love singing it. I could sing it forever. And so now, you know, it has a new life. It never has been lifeless to me. It's my favorite song to sing.
It's one of my favorite Sister Sledge songs too. Yeah. And it wasn't as big, obviously, in the US as it is here in the UK. And I remember really, really, you know, I knew the album, of course, growing up, but when I think it was Joey Negro, Dave Lee did a mix of it in the early 90s. And I remember buying it and thinking, oh my gosh, it's amazing. And now our mutual friend, Dimitri from Paris, has remixed it. Can you tell us how that came about?
You know, I'm not quite sure, but I know he collaborated on the Chic project to do this. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I also know that Thinking of You, I hear, is one of the most remixed songs in the UK. And I'm not surprised, you know. So I just, you know, now we just did a whole new quarantine remix. I mean, it just keeps resurfacing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I just know that meeting Dimitri, because I've done some concerts in Ibiza with him, with Glitterbox and with Defected Records. And he's always very reserved, very, you know, another stoic personality.
Playful thing.
And you know, then when he just gets up there and it's like this fire when he plays, you know, so I'm happy to be a part of one of his projects.
That's great. Well, he's also part of one of yours now. Yeah. Thinking of You, can you remember recording that in the studio with Bernard and Niles?
Yeah, and you know, if you listen closely, the formula of the background was always Luther Vandross and Alpha Anderson and Lucy Martin and Fonzie Thornton. That was the Chic sound. And they didn't want to deviate too much, Niall and Bernard, so they kept their backgrounds, you know, the sisters and I, we would sing, but they would always keep that formula underneath it. And I do remember with most of the recording with Niall Rogers and Bernard, the late Bernard Edwards, I was not allowed to hear anything until it was time to record it, including Thinking of You. Wow. And I think that to this day is why there's such a newness every time you hear it. I literally, someone just referenced it, which is starting to get a new name now. It's called The Happy Song. It makes people happy. I'm like, I love this. So, again, it was one of those songs where, as a lead singer, they would give me the song, and sometimes, like Greatest Dancer, I would learn it line for line. Everybody, let me tell you about my love. Okay, cut. Brought to you. And they teach it to me. Brought to you by an angel from above. You know, but I think with Thinking of You, I got a chance to be more fluid. So I would, in other words, I would learn it line for line, but then as I would record it, I got a chance to sing it verse by verse. And then I got familiar with how and where I wanted to take it. Mm-hmm. So I just think it's just one of those songs that I will never get tired of singing. In fact, I normally, when I post about it, I hashtag sing this with me, because before I sing it, wherever I am, I always say to the crowd, sing this with me. And everybody just sings at the top of their lungs, like every lyric. Mm-hmm. And that's just, it makes me feel really good.
Oh, well, let's have a listen and everyone can sing at home. I'm not gonna sing though, because I don't want everyone watching me getting the words wrong, because that will happen.
I'll do it.
I do make up my own words sometimes, but I think I know most of them. Anyways, let's have a listen. This is Dimitri's mix of Thinking of You by Sister Sledge.
Okay.
Such a great song. Such a wonderful song. Thank you for that gift to the world, Kathy.
Thank you. I was just listening to Bernard Edwards and Niall together. They were just magic together, you know.
They really were. What a unit. I mean, they really were really groundbreaking, you know. And absolutely. And I'm glad that Niall has had this kind of comeback in later life as well. Yeah. Fascinating book. If for those of you that haven't read his autobiography, his memoirs, it's incredible. Absolutely incredible. He's been through so much. Yeah. So much. Yeah.
Good guy.
Yeah. Now, the next song is a newer production from you with some good friends of ours, Horse Meat Disco. They're wonderful guys. I've known most of them for about 20 years, like since I moved here, and I just absolutely love them. And pardon?
Aren't they great? I love them.
Absolutely love them. Can you tell us how this project came about?
This project was actually Simon Dunmore's idea, mm-hmm. and Luke Solomon over at Defected Records. They sent me a track, and I love to write and collaborate, and they wanted me to write to this track that we're about to play. And I felt like, you know, I don't want to deviate too much from what they wrote. So we kept it simple. I may have added some background parts to it, but it was a great song and a great groove in it, and I love it. Falling in love, yeah. So that's how that started. It was just someone's idea that we should collaborate together, and we started by writing first. We've written many more since then, but this is the first.
Now, you wrote a lot of the songs. Well, you and your sister, I think you and Joni wrote quite a few songs, didn't you, for Sister Sledge, before you did We Are Family, when Bernard, I should say. Yeah. I go back and forth with American and British pronunciation. Bernard and Niall wrote the album. But before that, you and Joni, you were all writing, weren't you?
Yeah, we were all writing. Joni and I were the most, I guess you could say, we wrote the most. But when the We Are Family project, we really weren't allowed to write. Yeah. And I get it now, because they had an idea, they had a mindset of what they wanted, a formula. But before then, we wrote lots of songs on our albums and our projects. And after, of course, I've written, and I'm collaborating with more and more people now. Mm-hmm.
And what do you try to get across in songwriting? Do you have any kind of your own personal rules with songwriting? Or do you have some kind of topics that you like to cover, or some kind of feelings that you like to give people? Or is there something you want to convey that you feel like you need to convey every time you sing or write lyrics?
You know, a lot of it depends on the track. You know, sometimes I'll ask different writers, producers, songwriters, send me a track. Sometimes, like with Horse Meat Disco, actually, where we've written more songs together, we just woodshed. We get in a room and we just write together, which is a pretty cool way of writing. But it's whatever the music tells me, and that's how I get an idea of what to write with. And I've written, and I'm writing more. I just did a great jazz song with Stanley Clark, and I'm writing with Jan and Lewis, Jimmy Jam. And, you know, they send me tracks, and I just write what I feel, which... I'm loving.
Did you say you just did a song with Stanley Clark and Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis?
I did. With Jam, he actually sent me tracks like maybe three or four years ago. And he says he loves my voice. He goes, you know, he calls them Sledge Smashes. And we wrote one song that I stay on him. We wrote a song called We Could Turn This World Around. And it's very prophetic of what we're going on right now. And I'm staying on him now. I was like, I want to do this song. But I just love writing. And with Stanley, it started with my husband, Philip. We were working on a Billie Holiday project.
Yes.
With that said, we wrote a song that is the most beautiful jazz song. So we are, during our quarantine, we just had a phone meeting yesterday about, let's start getting back into writing and finishing a project.
Wow. Stanley Clark. In fact, I pulled that album out over quarantine, School Days.
Did you?
Such a great album. Such a great album. And then the other day I was playing SOS Band, Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis production, of course, and it's just being blown away because, you know, when SOS Band came out, and just, you know, Just Be Good to Me, like the way those keyboards go, I can talk about those guys forever. Anyways, let's have a listen to this great song that you do with Horse Meat Disco. It's called Falling Deep in Love with Kathy Sledge. Sorry, we have to fade that out. We got to get all these songs in there. It's such a tune.
I love those guys, and I love their grooves. I really
absolutely do. Me too. And I just really got it right on that one. You all got it right. Before I go any further, I also want to mention that tonight the proceeds, half of the proceeds, are going to Everybody Eats Philly. And it's the same with the stream. When we do stream this, we will be putting up a Just Giving or a GoFundMe link for Everybody Eats Philly. Could you tell us a bit about this charity?
Well, my daughter introduced it to me, and it's a charity that services in West Philadelphia, here in Philadelphia, and North Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. And they the backstory on their website tells you about how they just came together during this pandemic. And just there were so many people in need for meals when they got to that place. And not just meals, because I think they have a couple of chefs on board that actually prepare amazing meals, but at the same time, all the way from toiletries to toilet paper to anything you might need. And, you know, I've visited their website and just lines of people in need. And these people are just from Everybody Eats, their team. They just come out and just service and give. And it's just an act of love. So I definitely, you know, when you feel good, when you know that not only are you, when we come and listen to the classics, that you're actually giving back by supporting someone like Everybody Eats Philly.
Yeah, it's incredible how communities come together and they kind of fill in the gaps. So maybe where the government isn't really providing where it should. Yeah. But it's an amazing testament to the human spirit.
It is, isn't it?
And it really is. I mean, when times are tough, you can see the bad in people, but I have to say, you see, for me, I see so much good as well, and it's incredible.
Yes.
So fantastic charity. Now that kind of leads me into the next album that you chose, and it's an album I turned to immediately, pretty much as soon as lockdown happened, and it's an album I've turned to throughout my life. It's one of my top 10 favorite albums of all time, and I think it probably is for a lot of people, and that is Marvin Gaye, What's Going On.
Yeah. We don't even have to say anything about this, do we?
We really don't. I mean, I could tell you a whole history of the story, but you could do that on our Classic Album Sundays Facebook page. There is a video of me presenting the album where I tell the entire story of the album. So we're not going to do that now, but if anyone wants to do that at a later time, you can do that. It was my first Zoom, so the camera's all over the place. it was not like this. It wasn't like a TV studio.
But, we're learning fast, aren't we?
Yeah, exactly. Learning fast, learning very quickly. And it shows you how adaptable humans are as well. But with What's Going On, the thing that makes it so resonant today, and it has for so many, for ever since it was, it came out in 1971, mm-hmm. is the fact that these problems haven't gone away.
They're here.
Yeah.
You know, they haven't gone away. And you would think he was prophetic when he wrote the lyrics. And to think that years from now, you know, we are still living the same lyrics. But there's something different now. You know, I always say, I feel like Martin Luther, Marvin Gaye, Medgar Evers, Malcolm X, I think they would just have tears of joy to know that the whole world is marching and finally getting it to come together. This is a matter of the heart, I always say. You know, it really is. So his lyrics are just spot on.
Yeah.
And I actually revisited after the whole Black Lives Matter movement. I started listening, because with Songs of Comfort, I started singing songs that I thought would be relevant and could reach the heart. And this just jumped right out.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I think he actually I think Obi Benson from the Four Tops gave him this song, I believe. And
did he?
Yeah, I believe it was this one. And that's how the whole project kind of was started, because Marvin was working on with a band, I think was the name of the Originals. Mm-hmm. And but Obi Benson said, no, you need to record this. You have to record this. And
right.
He did. And of course, as soon as Berry Gordy heard it, he said it was the worst thing he'd ever heard.
Well, that's the case, isn't it? You know, sometimes, you know, it's up to the musician. They know. We know what we do.
Absolutely. But again, it really set a precedent as well for Motown and for artists like Stevie Wonder, who became so inspired. Yeah. They're really, I think everybody watching knows this song, but maybe when you listen to it tonight, listen to it in light of what's going on now, as opposed to what went on then. And it will have even more meaning. So let's have a listen to Marvin Gaye, What's Going On. Wow. Well, don't those lyrics sound relevant to today?
Yeah, it's like yesterday.
Yeah, it's incredible.
I mean, it's resurfacing everywhere because it hits home. It really mm-hmm. does.
So tell us about what's been, are you based in Philadelphia? Are you based in?
I'm based on the East Coast, right between Philadelphia and New York.
And New York, yeah.
Pennsylvania.
And what's it like over there now in New York and Philly?
Climate. it's very, very few cases here, right between New York and Philly, but and New York is starting, of course, to peak again.
Yeah.
And in Philadelphia, not as much, but I think we're starting to see the pattern. Whenever we get very comfortable, it starts peaking. So
the same's about to happen here too. Same thing.
Really, I was going to ask how in the UK.
Yeah, similar thing. They're easing restrictions, but we're going to have our second wave, I'm sure, very quickly. And that's my prediction, but I don't want to be, a bad news Betty or whatever, but, I think I'm being realistic.
Yeah, we're just being very, very wise about it.
Exactly, being pragmatic. In terms of the whole Black Lives Matter movement, what's going on near you? Is there still a lot of protests, or how are people feeling?
It's been very peaceful protest. And I think, again, like what we want to make sure, when I say we, I think the world, you do want to make sure that it's just not a craze and, we march and we all go home. I think it's more, there has been so much progress made as far as cultures reaching out to each other and understanding, because that's the start. That's the beginning of it. And I think it's very important to always stay diligent on making sure that we just don't let this go. And when I mean let this go, we all, and I really think this, I think it had so much impact with George Floyd. It's because the whole world, there are very little distractions going on now because we're all on lockdown. And I think everyone witnessed and saw that. And if you didn't have the only way that couldn't affect you is if you don't have a heart. Mm-hmm. And I think that's, that is what I'm seeing more of. I'm seeing people moving forward to making sure that we make changes, even if they're gradual changes, step by step.
I do think it had a bigger impact as well because of what's been happening around the world with COVID and this pandemic, because people are, they're more aware of what's going, they have less distraction and they can focus on certain news items that are happening as they unfold in front of them, and everyone is watching the news right now. But I think it's also more than that. I think that we've all had to become more reflective. And we've all had, our lives have all changed significantly.
Our lives are so fragile now. Life is so fragile now.
Yes. Yeah. Life is so fragile. Exactly. And we're all, I think many of us are thinking, do we want to go back to the way we were 100%?
Yeah.
And I think everyone.
When we say the new normal, it does make you reflect and go, was that normal? So far away from what is normal,
And we're making this new normal, and part of that is human rights. So, I've been speaking to a lot of my friends in the States, and I think there is a general feeling that change is happening. It's not as much as we want. We still keep seeing the same mistakes being made.
It's been hundreds and hundreds of years. So it's not going to happen overnight. But the beginning of, and I really mean that when I say the fact that the world came together, it's huge. Because, you always used to have maybe one group of people fighting for their rights. And now it was deeper than your rights. It was a matter of the heart. If you have a heart, you understand. And that's what I'm finding more and more.
Yeah. Well, this really ties into your last choice. And it's by one of my favorite singers of all time, Donny Hathaway. Mm-hmm. And there's something about Donny Hathaway's voice. I mean, I can get teary-eyed just talking about Donny Hathaway's voice. Wow. And this song is Someday We'll All Be Free, which has been used as almost an anthem for not Black Lives Matter, but in terms of, you know, civil rights even though it came out later. But actually he wrote it for different reasons. And he wrote it in 1973. It came out in his 1973 album, Extension of a Man. And it's when he was diagnosed with paranoid schizophrenia. Mm-hmm. And so this song, I think, is almost also had a lot to do with his emotional state at the time. And of course, there weren't a lot of treatments for that at the time in the early 1970s. And I don't know if everybody knows the history, but he did end up taking his own life not too long after 1979. Tragic, absolutely tragic. One of the great, great talents that lost way too soon. But this song has been adopted by the movement because the lyrics do tie into this. And it's someday we'll all be free. It's like a change is going to come. I mean, it is that message of positivity as well.
Well, yeah, there's that line, keep walking tall, hold your head up high. Yeah. Keep your head to the sky. You know, it's just, mm-hmm. it's walk with a straight back. You know, and I don't, you know, I'm sure he didn't realize what he was writing for, not for this cause, as you share that story with us, mm-hmm. but it couldn't get any more meaningful than what we're going through.
Absolutely.
So it's perfect, actually. The lyrics, they're so profound, and they pull on your heartstrings.
Well, let's have a listen. And for those of you that want, I think we actually have all the questions that we can take. So the question time, it will happen right after this. So let's have a listen to the wonderful, the inimitable Donny Hathaway with Someday We'll All Be Free.
Yeah, that can bring tears to your eyes.
It did to me. I actually fell into my microphone.
Well, I was trying not to cry.
Yeah, he really tugs on my heartstrings, that's for sure. Yeah. Anyways, well, thank you for all of those wonderful choices, Kathy. And I know we have a few people who would like to ask a question. We won't be able to get to all of them, but the first one is Orlando Seda. Hey, Orlando.
Hi, Colleen. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Thank you for having invited me to this great show.
Pleasure. Do you have a question for Kathy?
Yes, I do. First of all, this is unfair. Donny Hathaway, just before I come on. I mean, this is...
I know. I have a tear right here.
I'm still choked up here. Yeah. But nevertheless, I just wanted to, first of all, thank you, Kathy, for a great show and your selections, as Colleen has mentioned. Amongst all of your great producers and the musicians you have collaborated with previously, such as George Duke, Nile Rodgers, Stevie Wonder, just to name a few, which you have worked with previously, which production are you most proud of? And second part to the question is, which artists are you most excited about having worked with previously throughout your musical career?
Wow, that's a great question. The different producers that I've worked with, they're all so different. But the first one that comes to mind, I actually have to say, you mentioned George Duke. He was a genius. I loved working with him. And I think the most exciting experience, even though it was an interesting session, was with Nile Rodgers and Bernard Edwards, because obviously they gave us our hugest records and they had a vision. And I trust, you know, the first word that comes to mind, totally trusted what they were doing. But they're all so different, from Narda Michael Walden to George Duke, who's one of the nicest people you would have ever met. So I would have to say the Nile Rodgers Bernard Edwards experience was one of the most interesting and exciting. And artists, I would say, being able to do a duet with Al Jarreau. Well, I did a song with Al Jarreau on the George Duke project, and I'm a huge Al Jarreau fan. You know, he was just
love his voice.
His voice, his talent, his his timing, you know, his personality comes right through the voice. So I would say Al Jarreau, to be able to be, you know, grace a song with him on the George Duke project.
Fantastic. Can I ask you about another artist that you worked with too? I just want to give her a special mention, but didn't Gwen Guthrie do some writing for you on Circle of Love?
Oh, goodness.
Or no, Together. Was it Together?
It was Circle of Love.
Oh, it was Circle of Love. Okay.
Circle of Love. She wrote one song, Fireman. She was so ahead of her time.
Mm-hmm.
Gwen and Patrick wrote, like, I think mostly all the songs. Love Don't You Go Through No Changes on Me. It was on that album. Bert DiCutto produced it, but it was Circle of Love. Yes.
Yeah, she was amazing too.
Tremendous writer.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Orlando.
Thank you, Orlando.
Sorry to hijack your question, but I always get a bit muso, so you know me. Our next question is from Sirica. Are you there, Sirica?
I am. Hi, Colleen.
Hi.
Hi, Kathy. Thank you so much for inviting me to this. This has been an amazing experience.
Oh, pleasure.
Oh, thank you.
My question kind of backs off of Orlando's. He happened to type it faster than I do. And again, with the roster of people that you've worked with, Kathy, who's left on your wish list of artists, producers, today or of yesterday, that you would have liked a chance to collaborate with or want a chance to work with in the future?
I would say, I'm not sure if he's doing any more producing, but Quincy Jones. And I was blessed to be able to have Christmas dinner at Quincy Jones's. I was invited by Saida Garrett, who's an amazing songwriter.
Oh, yeah, she's great.
Her husband invited us. But I got a chance to, you know, just say hello again. I've known him through the years. But I think he's another tremendous producer, songwriter. I would say Quincy. And then I am writing with Jam and Lewis. They're like second to none when it comes to Niall and Bernard. You know, there's some great producer teams out there like Gamble and Huff and Niall and Bernard and Jam and Lewis. And I would love to be able to do some more things with them maybe one day.
Gosh, I can't wait to hear this stuff. I hope it comes out. I hope it comes out soon.
I'm going to stay with them about it. We all get so busy. Yeah. There's one song in particular that I love. So we'll see.
Fantastic. Well, thanks, Sirica.
Thank you.
Our next question is from Gina Lapsley.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, this is an amazing session. I feel so privileged to be here. I wanted to ask Kathy, a recent song that has made you lost in music.
Oh, good one.
Lost in music?
She says a recent song.
You know,
song.
That feeling you get when I dance to that song, I feel lost in music. A recent song that you say, wow, this really does it for me.
A recent song?
Yeah.
That reminds me of lost in music?
No, that you really like in the way that
but
one would feel. The feeling you get of being lost in music.
That's a great question.
It is. It's a difficult one. But it doesn't have to be too new.
I would have to say kind of like Fallen Deep in Love. Yeah. Lost in Music was a groove song. And it just stayed in this place. You know, I mean, Lost in Music did. And I think Fallen Deep in Love again reminds me, especially the Joey Negro remix. It just grooves that way. And the bass line is, it rides. And so I would say that's the song that gives me the same kind of feel.
Oh, beautiful. Wonderful. And we have, thank you, Gina.
Thank you, Gina.
We have one more song. One more person who has a question. And that's Harry Varzabatian. Harry, are you there?
Hello.
Hi, Harry.
Greetings from Athens, Greece.
Greetings.
Wow, greetings.
This is the great thing about these kinds of events. It's around the world. Sorry.
I love it.
Yeah, it is.
We all would be there right now, Harry.
The weather is very, very sunny and warm here in Greece right now.
Nice.
We are not in quarantine anymore here. It's been easy for us the last few months and the last few days. It's better. I hope that you end with your quarantine soon and we can keep on with our lives again.
Yes.
I'm feeling very, you know, I'm a little bit, I'm so honored to be here right now. I can't believe that I can ask you a question. thank you, Colin. Thank you so much. The question is just about what is your opinion about how you see the music industry and the music in general today compared to the past?
I actually really like what I'm seeing today more and more. It got to a place where at one point all the music started sounding the same. But I think what I'm seeing more, there's more unique artists coming out. And I'm also seeing a lot of the earliest, I'm seeing a whole new resurgence of an audience. Like, for instance, there are kids out in the audience that weren't even born when I sang Thinking of You at 16 years old, but they're embracing the music. And I think because of the internet and because people are getting to choose their music and not being spoon-fed the music through just the radio, I think people are choosing what they like, and we're starting to see some amazing artists and unique artists. And also, I think the ear is becoming more and more diverse. And that's why I really believe songs like Thinking of You just starts resurfacing, because it's good music. So I'm liking what I'm seeing. I'm seeing people choose the music they like, and there's so many artists out there, but there's room for everyone. That's what I honestly believe.
That's beautiful. Thank you so much, Harry. So, wow. Well, do you have, when are you doing your next Songs of Comfort, in case anybody wants to tune in?
Oh, yeah. Actually, I'll be doing a Songs of Comfort this weekend. And I posted on Facebook. It's just Kathy Sledge on Facebook. You can follow me. And in my Instagram, of course, I always post it on my IG, Instagram. I'm just Kathy Sledge on Instagram. And all of my, I'm building the website more, kathysledge.com. But soon we'll be uploading everything on the site. But for now, you can find it on Facebook. And I'll be posting it this week. And you maybe one of the songs you heard today I might be doing, maybe A Lovely Day or the one we just heard.
I was thinking that, the Donny Hathaway.
Yeah, someday we'll all be free. Gosh. I actually have tracked that with musicians, and that's ready to go. So
when I was listening to it, I thought Kathy has to do this song. I'm sure it's on her wish list to do this one, because it's just so poignant.
It's pretty emotional. It's the only reason I haven't done it yet. Mm. You know, there's a very, very talented artist, Bryant Pugh, who does a lot of gospel music and a lot of jazz music. And he collaborated with me, and he sent me this gorgeous track. He did it right away. And I haven't been able to actually emotionally sing the song. Mm. It's been a little emotional, but now I will, especially after today.
Oh, good, good.
We almost had tears in our eyes, I think.
I did.
And I know. I couldn't look at you. I was looking at you.
Well, thank you so much, Kathy. I wish you all the best of luck with the new music as well. I got to hear this, you know, the stuff that you're doing with Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis. And I got to, is it also with Stanley Clark? Is that all one production, or is that a separate one?
Stanley Clark, I know we have to go, but the Stanley Clark song, he actually told me, which is huge to me, that he feels I have one of the strongest jazz voices he's ever heard in a long time.
Wow.
That blew me away. And then he proceeded to play a song for me that sounds like it's from the soundtrack of Porgy and Bess with the full orchestration. And I actually cried. And the song is called I wrote the lyrics to it. It's called My Forever. And it's just beautiful. So then, of course, we went through the quarantine. And now we actually had a conference, my husband, and he had a call about starting up again. So stay tuned.
Please, you know, please.
I can't wait to do that stuff. It's all good.
That's fantastic. Well, thank you so much for everything you've been doing. Thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you for choosing Everybody Eats Philly as well.
Yes, and thank you. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks to everyone. And thanks to everyone attending. Thanks to our moderator as well. He's worked very hard. And again, thank you, Kathy. And thanks everyone for listening. Have a lovely evening.
Stay safe. Love you and thank you.